You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
My name is Nancy Erb. Welcome to Intercultural Conflict Resolution, Negotiation, and Peacebuilding. That's a long title, and I think from now on I will probably say intercultural or cross-cultural conflict resolution. I think you get the picture. I am happy to be broadcasting this show from one of the most diverse campuses in the Western United States, California State University, Dominguez Hills. If you haven't yet visited our campus, we are located in Carson, California, bordering Compton, California. And last we surveyed our campus, we had staff, faculty, students speaking somewhere over 60 different languages. We truly pride ourselves, and we're relatively, compared to the big CSUs like San Diego State or Long Beach State, we pride ourselves in being a more intimate community where with students and faculty have very close mentoring relationships. Even though all of the Cal State campuses say they are teaching institutions, from my experience teaching here for over a decade, we really pride ourselves in what I will call experiential, hands-on service learning, where our students are actually engaged with the communities that they will be eventually serving, learning leadership skills within these communities, and doing the same in our classrooms. It's a nice way for me to introduce and say a little bit more about my very unusual interdisciplinary field, negotiation, conflict resolution, and peacebuilding. It's the only program of its type in the world, to my knowledge. And I was at UC Berkeley teaching multicultural conflict resolution in peace studies there when the Rotary International decided to combine conflict resolution and peace studies as part of international studies with their Rotary Peace Scholar. I'm pretty familiar in my work over the last two decades, traveling the world, teaching in Europe, for example, at the University of Oslo, Norway, and working in the Middle East, having Fulbrights in both Cyprus and the West Bank, and most recently, a Fulbright Distinguished Chair at Phuket, Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. I'm pretty aware of what's happening with conflict resolution and peace studies around the world. And I think I can confidently say this is a very rare program because we believe that you must learn the skills of what Harvard Negotiation Project called integrative or win-win negotiation and do that in a diverse multicultural setting. To really prepare yourself to build peace. It's not enough to simply want social justice, no matter how passionately you want social justice. In today's connected, diverse world, you must be actively learning how to bridge culture. Let me briefly introduce myself with a couple of my most recent books to give you a picture of this. This is my most recent book, Creating a Sustainable Vision of Nonviolence in Societies and Schools. And I edited this book. With Swaranjit Singh, a retired colonel from India, and had contributions with authors from several different countries around the world. I loved the chapters on nonviolent teaching in Spain, for example, or tackling police corruption in South Africa with nonviolent protest, transforming Sweden through nonviolence education. Sweden is one of many European countries that is struggling with its refugee immigrant population from the Iraq and Afghan wars. And so these are chapters in which authors from these different cultures and countries are proposing how various aspects of conflict resolution and peace building, its very practical, effective processes like nonviolence, truly can make a critical difference at this point in history. Here's another example. This is a book that I authored by myself. Negotiation Alchemy actually provides case studies of the work that I did in the Balkans when I was working with the Norwegian NGO, the Nansen Network, in facilitating cross-ethnic dialogue. It also provides case studies of my students' work in various countries like Cameroon, where one of my students from the University of Oslo, Norway, has spent much of his lifetime mediating between previously warring violent tribes and doing so quite effectively. He describes in great detail the work that he did there. It also includes, because my work and our work in negotiation, conflict resolution, and peacebuilding is local as much as it's global. I'm just trying to give you a really quick snapshot of some of its reach. Negotiation Alchemy also includes the success story of Santi High, for example. After horrific violence, how the principal was able to create a peace council, get money for more mental health counselors, and very much engage the local community in turning that violence around. It includes some of my practical experience working with violent repeat juvenile offenders and how mediation dramatically reduced their violence, exactly how that occurred. So I hope you're getting a sense of how far-ranging and practical my program is and how perfectly suited my campus is for this study. Now with this show, I am hoping to hear from more of you throughout my home county, Los Angeles, and my neighboring county, beautiful Orange County, to hear exactly what you are doing, how you are living our rich, diverse, multicultural life in Southern California. Now, before I talk about some of the challenges that we face living here, I would like to talk about some of the reasons that I truly love living and working here, besides the natural beauty, you know, the diverse, rich, multicultural community. I really believe, given my career of working with multicultural teams here in this country, corporations visiting from countries like Japan to study our diversity and how, you know, to effectively have their companies here, and also working with people around the world, that this point in history is a golden opportunity, not only for the gold that I hear is currently being mined in the hills of California, but for the innovation that California is renowned for throughout the world. Our diversity is our strength. And, you know, in doing this show throughout Los Angeles and Orange County, I know we're broadcasting to what they call the choir. I mean, we all live here. We all live with a variety of cultures, languages. And when I ask my friends what they appreciate most, they generally say the cuisine. And so we appreciate this diverse way of living, this global way of living, more than most. But I don't think we have even started to tap into the potential for innovation if we are able to effectively build truly inclusive multicultural teams. We simply, most people, most leadership, and I don't have a copy of my collection on cross-cultural collaboration and leadership for modern organizations, but that is just one example of where I explore and other authors explore the ways that the tools, the skills, the processes that are necessary to deeply, fully embrace the wealth of a cultural perspective, experience, way beyond understanding their, you know, country of birth markets. Truly, we have, if we come together, such potential for doing what all teachers of creativity and innovation promote. And I hope in one of my shows to start to introduce how the skills and the processes that students learn in my program really work well for cross-cultural, multicultural leadership and team building. We have, last I looked, 140 countries represented in Los Angeles County, and over 200 languages spoken. So, you know, if any of you are, you know, creativity gurus or people who studied creative problem solving, or maybe you're artists of all types, musicians, visual, performance, you can get a picture of all the possibilities, even if you only think in simplistic linear ways. I mean, every time you bring in a diverse something combination, there is potential to create something entirely new. Now, why don't we see this more often? We'll be talking about that as well in this show, because most of us like to hide out in the comfort of our own culture, our own upbringing, our own country, our own language. It takes courage. It takes the ability to tolerate discomfort, to cross over into a different world. We get a little bit more incentives here in this community. In this show, I hope to highlight some of them so you can discover some of the different possibilities. Now, I had a dilemma when I was asked to do this show because I have a very rich multicultural, multi-religious, multi-country alumni network. My program is an on-campus undergraduate major and an online international graduate master's or postgraduate certificate. And so when students are in the graduate program in particular, they are with students from around the world. But actually, the beauty of Dominguez Hills and being in Los Angeles is more likely than not, that's also true on campus. We currently have students visiting and studying our classes from Germany and Japan as two examples this semester. And we often have sometimes refugees in our classrooms, most recently Syrian refugees, but also immigrants from a wide range of countries. particularly in my experience teaching in my field, African and African American students are particularly interested in studying these skills and these tools. And if you don't know, Dominguez Hills is a Latino-serving institution. So the majority of our students are Spanish-speaking Latinos from around the world. Okay, anyways, that was Los Angeles County. Orange County, most of us, at least those of us who have known about Orange County for, I've been in now teaching in California for over two decades, think of Orange County as primarily white suburbia, even though I must say I have known many of the Latino community from Orange County. But the outside perspective is pretty much affluent white suburbia. Well, that, you know, does not reflect the number of countries and languages in Orange County. It's not LA County, but last I looked, there are residents who reflect over 50 different countries, particularly Asian and Latin countries, and over 35 languages. Oh, and the other thing that I find fascinating is the number of residents who were born and migrated from the Middle East who live in Orange County. So it's really quite a diverse group, just like Los Angeles County. All of it very rich. Well, here's the dilemma. We have this rich alumni network, if you don't mind, I'll call my program NCRP. And I want you to meet some of them because they're from fascinating cultures. They've also studied negotiation and conflict resolution skills so they can tell you in an intimate, personal way how what they learned actually made a difference in every aspect of their lives, personal and professional. And that is no matter what the culture, what the community, that is routinely what I have heard from our students over many years. The skills they learn make a difference in every aspect of their lives, personal and professional. But what I want to be asking them about is, in particular, how did it affect you in crossing culture, in living an intercultural life? Now, many of you in Los Angeles and Orange County are living a bit of my life. And so before I move on, I want to say, here's the dilemma. How often do I interview these fascinating, diverse people about the very practical impact of learning and developing negotiation and conflict resolution skills, especially in their multicultural lives? Or how much do I share my own personal knowledge and experience facilitating multicultural, cross-cultural processes? Because I do know which skills can make a real difference. And so I'm not going to actually conclusively come up with a formula here. I'm going to let this, as I do in much of my work, organically evolve. But I would like to ask you to help me with this, because I know some of you are living my life. I was blessed, fortunate enough to be born into a multicultural family with grandparents and great aunts and uncles who were recent immigrants to the United States. My grandmother and her siblings, her family, they were all born and spent some time in Norway before migrating to the United States. And her husband, my grandfather, had lived in the United States and farmed in the United States for a couple of generations, but they still spoke German as much as English. So I grew up listening to three different languages and experiencing these different cultures. I will say, given what I do today, this was a gift and a blessing because my students and my community who share my childhood are what I call born mediators, born cross-cultural mediators. We have an intuitive intelligence, an ability to bridge culture and work with people that is, I have spent my whole career trying to figure out how to teach. It's not easy to do. In fact, I've done research that I hope to be able to share in this course that came out of my question, why do so many people from different cultures and countries around the world come to me to do cross-cultural, multicultural work? And one of my answers is, I was gifted enough to be born into this multicultural family. Now, it was multicultural in different ways, and for the purpose of this course, I don't want to just stick to ethnic, tribal culture, linguistic culture, or religious culture. I'd like to be very broad in how we define this because one of my alumni who has agreed to come on the show is, like me, from a multicultural family, a Jewish mother who married a Costa Rican father. But what I hope to ask him about, despite the fact that Nicholas has gone to Israel and lived on a kibbutz, and I do want to hear his thoughts about peace building and conflict resolution with our most horrific cross-cultural challenges, but he and his twin brother are both surfers, and they are part of the Los Angeles Orange County surfing culture, and having now lived here for over a decade and enjoyed my surfing culture community students, I want to be able to go into some of what defines our community and probably is not discussed in any of the cross-cultural, multicultural textbooks, but for example, that inspirational surfer, that young girl who had her arm taken off by a shark and came back to continue surfing with that spirit of facing any challenge that comes her way. I mean, that's the kind of culture that our young people around the world need to hear and see in order to feel inspired, encouraged, lifted up. So that's one example. And on the flip side of that, now, I myself, given my family's ancestry, may have a bit of Jewish culture in my ancestry. And as we all know, hopefully we all know the horrific Holocaust against Jewish people. That is like the flip side of inspirational culture. It's the side of, and it's one, you know, this hate-filled culture that has been in the media constantly in, you know, recent months. Pick the country. I must say I'm most concerned about my own. It doesn't fit with my life experience in any way. Very little. I mean, yeah, I have occasionally had a very closed-minded, prejudiced, hate-filled, fear-filled person cross my paths, enter my classrooms, but generally not. And so exploring on the flip side, and I will probably ask Nicholas about this too, what is it about LA and Orange County? I don't know if you know this, but given what I teach, I'm well aware that California, this golden progressive state that I love, that many of us love, is the leader in the United States for hate groups, for hate crimes. And part of that is because of our population and our diversity, but it's not okay with me that we have been targeting the same groups the whole, you know, two decades I have lived here and taught conflict resolution and peace studies. And I would love to hear from those of you comfortable calling in or even writing me. You can get my email if you Google my name. Write me with your concerns. I want to hear the best and the worst of our community because you are my community, but also because, as you've heard, I just love so much about our community. It's like a perfect place for me to be in many ways, but that we continue to have, let's see if I have the statistic close by our number of hate groups. No, I don't have it close by today. I'll get it for the future. But we lead, and Orange County, Southern Poverty Law Center, used to study Orange County before any part of the United States for hate groups. What is that all about? Now, some of it is that my students who live here, who've grown up here, my friends, my colleagues will say, this is an incredibly materialistic culture. And we certainly have our share of the 1%, the extreme discrepancy between very poor and extremely wealthy. And some of that could explain what goes on, except I don't think the people who are the haters can use that as an excuse. I don't think they're, from what I know, and let me tell you who gets targeted, because I would like to hear from some of you, and I want to hear some of what's happening to address this, to, you know, build peace across culture, to get to know each other in humane ways. I mean, anything you want to bring up. And actually, if you'd like to be a guest on the show, I don't have a lot of slots open at the moment, but I would try to do what I could. But the people who have been targeted the whole time I've been living and working here have not changed, despite what people say. The groups who are the primary targets of hate crime in California, in Southern California, are Jewish Americans, African Americans, and gay men. Not all of the gay community, but gay men. And you know, I am not, do I need to say this, given what I stand for and the life I've led, I am not for scapegoating, attacking, bullying, excluding anybody. And even though I'm not a traditional Christian, I was raised Christian, I do very much believe that if you call yourself Christian, you are called to live, not just preach, but live the gospel of love towards all people. And so that hate exists in a community. Now, my students are, you know, Muslim and Buddhist, Sikh, you know, pick the world religion. They're all the world religions living here together. But I do know there is a strong evangelical Christian community. And hearing your thoughts, not on judging or criticizing or hating anybody, and this is not a show to be reading me man-written scripture from any world religion, but this is a place where if you can talk about how you are living your faith, how you are living multicultural love, acceptance, tolerance, creating safe spaces. Now, if any of you are young and tuning in, you know, you won't see this when I'm sitting down, but I was born to Norwegian immigrants, so I'm a tall woman, tall and strong. And when I was young, I would defend the children on the playground who were being bullied. And then I grew up and became a STEM star, actually. And if some of you are STEM culture, science, technology, engineering, math, and you're getting taunted, harassed, you know, discriminated against in your schools, if particularly, I'm going to say, if you're a woman, if you're a girl, these are cultural issues we need to discuss too. Because, you know, the fact that for my whole lifetime, the cool, you know, cliques, groups, are athletes, talented athletes, and pretty subservient cheerleaders who put men first. You know, some of these cultures need to change. I'm not going to go against talented athletes. I'm married to one and the daughter of another. I love talented athletes as much as anyone. But we should, you know, these cultural issues that we live on a day-to-day basis, isn't it time we start to celebrate the brightest students, celebrate the artists of the school, celebrate the outspoken who raise social justice issues? Now, some of you are actually in families, in schools where this is happening, and I would love to hear from you because these are some of the cultural issues. You know, the worst of intercultural conflict is violence, hate, war. And I mentioned I was facilitating cross-cultural dialogue during the Balkans War. I have spent time working with the worst conflicts in the Middle East over my career. We have got to change our attitudes in our families. In our, however we identify, in our gender, it is not okay for masculinity to still be defined by the most violent person on the block. It is not okay that still 1 in 3 women, mothers, wives in the home, is being assaulted, is being violently abused. It's not okay for children to be abusing each other. None of it's okay, and it has been my, because when we tolerate violence, hatred, hurting others, and allow the natural pecking order of who's the most ruthless, violent, you know, no conscience bully, the world looks like it looks today. It's no surprise to me that we are seeing what we're seeing today if this is what we're promoting. Now, a lot of times teachers and parents will say to me, boys will be boys. But I want to hear from some of the boys and the men who do not believe in glorifying and rewarding violence. I also, some of my students are returning vets who are able to share the realities of what they signed up for when they served in our military. That, you know, our leading employer promotes violence against people around the world is part of why we're in the mess we're in right now. Now, some of you, and you may even call in and say this to me, really believe in tit-for-tat violence. You've decided you're going to, you know, fill up your home with guns, and you're teaching all your kids to use them. Well, I'm going to tell you, as someone who has been teaching peacebuilding, and that includes de-escalating violence in the toughest of instances, if you're combining those weapons with alcohol or drugs, that's a lethal formula. And you look at what's happening, you know, with the violence in our schools. So we have a lot of cultural discussions that we can have on this show. And I do want to hear about some of your challenges. But that said, I also want to be sharing what works, what helps, what can bring hope, no matter how dark the situation, no matter how troubling. There are ways for every child, every young person, every woman, every community, no matter how historically oppressed and downtrodden and held back, to create a safe, peaceful, you know, space for themselves, to build alliances with people that can help them get out of the worst of hate and violence. Now, I'm well aware, and I don't expect that I'm going to hear from anybody who's in this country as an immigrant without legal protection. But I'm well aware that I lived by invitation with a migrant farm worker and his family when I was a young college student. And I lived in the housing projects with them. And I know some of the barriers to reaching out and getting protection. But you know, you go back in our history with our Underground Railroad. And you know, with the domestic abuse communities creating safe spaces and shelter, there are still options and alternatives for people. If we're talking about the worst of hate, violence, war, crime. Now, sadly, in recent years, with all we've been going through as a country, the hate crime rate increased almost 3 times the amount in Los Angeles and Orange County that it did in the rest of the United States. What is going on? Now, the good news, I want to hear from some of you in Long Beach, my home. Because, you know, Long Beach, you moved to Long Beach partially because you do love the multicultural diversity of this, you know, of SoCal. So part of it is probably that we choose Long Beach. But that's, you know, that's a little overly simplistic. I'm well aware of the history of Long Beach. But Long Beach, their hate crimes went down. While the rest of Los Angeles County and Orange counties went up. There's something really wrong. And I, you know, if some of you tuning in are LAPD, my program started years ago to empower you. We've had many of you come through our classrooms, and I would like to hear some insights. Part of it is what goes on within our police force. You know, there's a whole group in the world, and mostly faith-based people, Catholic theologians have led this, who believe that if we could create consistently just policing, meaning we clean up the forces of all corruption and crime, all discrimination and neglect of impoverished communities, we could end war. We could end war as a globe if we could figure out a way to promote and maintain just policing. Police that respond to poor communities of color as quickly as they do the upper 1%. So if you want to share some of your perspective on that, it's welcome. Let's see. I have shared a lot here that's pretty heavy. And I guess it reflects the times, but I'm also open to sharing the best of why we love knowing each other and living next door to each other. You know, in Long Beach, the common answer, I mentioned it before, is cuisine. But some of you have liberated yourself from oppressive cultural norms by mirroring outside of the culture of your parents and your ancestors. And I happen to think that you are our greatest hope for peace, that you have created a cross-cultural marriage and created a cross-cultural family. Now, I have asked a couple of my gay friends who have adopted an African-American little girl if they would be willing to come on the show and talk about, you know, the gay community's commitment to adopting the older, differently abled, unadoptable children of the country in the area. Now, I know some of you are, there's all sorts of controversy around mixing cultural groups, but for an intercultural conflict resolution course, I would like to hear from those of you who are living intercultural peace. So whether, you know, it's your marriage, it's your adopted children, however you're doing this, because day to day you are learning how to embrace difference and somehow resolve it, at least good enough to stay together. Now, some of you might have, you know, war stories of how you romantically tried to do this and you weren't able to. That's okay. Calling in with challenges is welcome too. Others of you may not have married across culture, but if some of you, especially women, have been born into cultures which oppress and discriminate against women, like the American culture, I would like to hear from you and hear how you've been working to liberate yourself and perhaps at the same time speak truth to power and advocate for justice in your lifetime. That's a conversation I would love to have. I've been living that one. Some of you haven't married across culture, but you work with cross-cultural teams, multicultural teams. Once again, I welcome your success stories, and I also welcome calls with your challenges so that I can very specifically suggest possible tools, possible approaches that would fit your particular scenario. I really want, this is my vision for this program, and we're only broadcasting through Los Angeles and Orange County, but I want to celebrate this community because I believe the world has so much to learn from us. Oh, here's the other group. Musicians for Peace, the drummers on the beaches who get together. We have so many ways that artists cross culture and do multicultural art in LA. This would be a wonderful forum to celebrate some of that as well. I think the fundamental question for those of us who live multicultural lives and love our multicultural lives, that we need to somehow be able to communicate and help others understand is why, if I had a choice, here I am, I live in California Heights, if some of you know California Heights in Long Beach. And Long Beach has a horrible history of segregation. You know, there was a black neighborhood and a white neighborhood. And then, you know, gang violence erupted, and there's a lot of history there. So people who have lived there and know Long Beach often identify one side as the white neighborhood and the other as the neighborhood of color. Here's one way that someone has asked me about my life. Why would I choose to live between the communities of warring gangs? You know, that's the prejudiced view of my life. Now, my life, I have worked with gang-affiliated, in my mind, children when I worked with repeat violent juvenile offenders. I mean, some were as young as 6 years old. I have also had former gang members in my classrooms, as well as those who have tragically lost family. This is not a question of where we live. If anyone who is familiar with crime in Los Angeles and Orange County knows it's much more complicated. But the question we need to answer for everyone is, why do I choose to live in the neighborhood that is more diverse? I'll tell you one reason is it has more artists than any other neighborhood in Long Beach. It's a shorter commute to my campus. And I love my multicultural community. When I first moved to SoCal, Pepperdine brought me down to Malibu. And I was like, what do people do here after they've enjoyed the beach? I then went to West LA, Santa Monica, and I asked everyone, where is your diverse community? My question would be, why are you living with people who think like, act like, look like you, and not the world? Okay. Well, I look forward to joining you again next week. Hope to hear from several of you.